Hi, welcome to the University of São Paulo School of Medicine. My name is Signe Grasel, and this is our team. Dr. Edgar Almeida, Dr. Roberto Beck, Dr. Amanda Rossi, Dr. Ricardo Loureiro, Dr. Jacqueline Quintanilla. We are ENT doctors and do the elective physiological tests at the Department of Otolaryngology at our University Hospital in São Paulo, Brazil. Today, we'll show you how we do electrocochleography. Electrocochleography is mostly used in patients with meningitis symptoms, but it may be useful in other clinical conditions. As it shows nicely cochlear microphonics, it is popular for studying auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder, and sometimes may be helpful in other cochlear diseases. Clinicians may use it as well as a complement for ABR, when wave 1 cannot be correctly identified. Here we show you what we need for electrocochleography. These are the instruments we used for preparing and cleansing the ear canal before the test. You see ear specula in different sizes, curette, alligator forceps, suction tips, straight pick, and nasal specula. We like to use topical anesthesia with 10% lidocaine spray. We use also saline solution to improve electrical conduction. As our patients usually experience dizziness, we use lidocaine and saline solution at 37 degrees Celsius. It is much more comfortable for the patient. This is the TM electrode. We leave it for 5 minutes in saline solution. In a couple of minutes, you will see how we place it on the tympanic membrane. Therefore, we need the electron tone. We need as well surface electrodes and new prep for skin preparation, like for a traditional ABR test. Now we show you the patient preparation. Be sure that she is in a comfortable position. A pillow may be helpful. First of all, we use the microscope for a careful otologic examination. Here you see the ear canal. All earworks and debris must be completely removed. Here we go. Now you see the tympanic membrane. You should be sure to see every single aspect of the tympanic membrane. Special attention to perforation, which sometimes may be very tiny, but must be identified before going on with the preparation. The ear canal is fine, the tympanic membrane is normal, no calcifications, no perforation, no retraction pockets. Now Dr. Almeida will fill up the ear canal with warm lidocaine solution and leave it for about 10 minutes. The same procedure will be done on the other ear. Which ear should be tested first? We always choose first the ear with a better threshold. If both ears have equally good thresholds, you can start on the side with less symptoms, for example, less oral pressure, less tinnitus. Meanwhile, we will prepare the skin and fix the surface electrodes using contact cream. This is the way we put the electrodes into the pre-amplifier. For the right ear, the jumper is placed into the right socket and ground. The right ear lobe electrode is connected to the blue socket, and the forehead electrode is plugged into the white socket. Now, Dr. Almeida will put 1 milliliter of warm saline solution into the ear canal. After a minute, he is now removing all liquids from the ear canal. The ear canal and the tympanic membrane should be absolutely dry and clean to receive the TM electrode. The TM electrode with electron gel on the tip is carefully positioned on the tympanic membrane, posterior inferiorly. Be sure not to place the electrode on the malleus manubrium. Now, Dr. Almeida will connect the electrode to the cable and fix it with the insert earphone. The insert earphone will help to fix the TM electrode on the tympanic membrane. Now it is time to test impedance. For the TM electrode, an impedance of 20 kOhm is usually acceptable. We will start our test now and ask the patient to relax, close the eyes and maintain the head position. This is the eclipse screen with our electrocochleography protocol. First of all, we use a standard click stimulus at a rate of 11 per second in high intensities at 90 dB hearing level. We use the alternate polarity to enhance SP and AP and to eliminate cochlear microphonics when the cochlear microphonics are not of interest. Actually, the software permits to study separately the curves obtained by condensation and rarefaction stimuli. This can be done offline after the test. It is important to observe the baseline. It should be smooth. Remember to disconnect the microscope from the power supply before starting the test. We choose the side and begin the test. We find it helpful to analyze first the waveform morphology and AP latency. It is a good procedure to collect several curves and to select the best curves for analysis. As proposed by Pu et al. From the Howe's Ear Institute, we use as norm values an SP-AP amplitude ratio of 35%. But this equipment offers more criteria, like the SP-AP area ratio proposed by Ferraro. Here you see how we identify the SP AP peak AP1 and AP2. Actually, the software calculates the composed AP and SP area, which here is called the SP area. Here you see the AP area. And the software gives you the area ratio, SP over AP. Another criteria you may use for hydrops is the AP latency difference observed between condensation and rarefaction clicks. We will do this analysis here. An AP latency difference of 0.38 milliseconds or higher is considered abnormal, as proposed by Margolis. In this case, it is normal. You can also test tone bursts. This may be especially helpful in cases of auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder. For demonstration, we show here 1 kHz tone burst. So we go back to the setup protocol and select the 1 kHz tone burst. For a routine test, we keep the alternate polarity. Be sure to expand the time baseline to show the AP, which is supposed to appear at around 3 milliseconds. You see, the amplitude is smaller than a click amplitude. This is expected because only the neurons at around 1000 Hz will respond to the frequency-specific stimulus. Now we will analyze condensation and rarefaction curves separately. Here you see the cochlear microphonics. About 200 electrocochleographies per year at our clinic. Now we will show you some of our previously collected chrysemes. This is a patient with papillomavirus disease. She has vertigo attacks for about 2 years, bilateral tinnitus and oral pressure, worse on the right ear. As you see, her hearing test is normal, so are the reflexes and the tympanogram. And this is her electrocochleography test. On the left side, you see a small SP, a well-formed AP, and normal ratios for SP-AP amplitude and SP-AP area on both curves. Looking at the right ear test, you see that the duration of the composed SP and AP is enlarged as compared to the left side. The SP amplitude is increased, and so are the SP-AP amplitude and SP-AP area ratios. In a recent study at our institution with normal hearing patients with no Meniere's disease, we found that the mean value for the SP-AP area is 1.25 with a 0.25 standard deviation. So, the upper limit, considering two standard deviations, would be 1.75 for the SP-AP error ratio. Both values on the right ear test are above the upper limit, as you see. Here, you see the AP latency of condensation and rarefaction clicks. This is a manual measure, but you see the difference is small on the right ear and there's no difference at all on the left ear. In this case, the AP latency difference is of no help for diagnosis, but it may be very helpful in other cases. This is a 35-year-old female diagnosed with auditory neuropathy at age 12. This is her audiogram. She has abnormal thresholds on both ears and no speech discrimination. Otoacoustic emissions are better than expected for the hearing threshold. Here you see the right ear test and here the left ear test. This is her ABR test. You see the curves for rarefaction and condensation clicks. there are no waves at 90 dB HL. And this is her electrocochleography test. There's no neural response. This is a 1000 Hz tone burst. You see the cochlear microphonics obtained by reflection condensation stimuli. How do we know that this is a real cochlear microphonic potential and not an artifact? So we clamp the earphone and deliver the stimulus, but there's no response. This proves that this is a real cochlear microphonic and not an artifact. Here you see the 500 Hz tone burst response. The cochlear microphonic has a longer duration, about 6 milliseconds, much larger than the 1000 Hz response. Once again, clamping the earphone, the response should disappear. And as you see here, it does. This is a 61-year-old lady with progressive hearing loss on the right ear, dizziness and tinnitus. According to Gibson, she scored 6, and according to the American Academy of Otolaryngology, had a probable Meniere's disease. Her MRI study was unremarkable. Her auditorium shows normal hearing on the left side and a sensory neural hearing loss on the right side with thresholds between 60 and 70 dBHL. Thresholds are quite different between both ears. And here is her electrocochleography test. On the left side, you see a nice curve, a small SP and a normal-sized AP with normal SP-AP amplitude and area ratios. On the right side, the most important finding is the reduced AP amplitude. This may be due to her hearing loss, with loss of inner hair cells, spiral ganglion cells, so less neurons are responding to the stimulus. So, in this case, we are cautious not to mark an altered SP-AP ratio, because the ratio may be abnormal, mostly to the reduced AP amplitude and not to an enlarged SP amplitude. In this case, a VEMP may be probably the better choice for looking at signs of Meniere's disease. The Eclipse software offers several tools to establish the diagnosis of cochlear hydrates, SP-AP amplitude ratio, area of the composed SP and AP potential, SP-AP error ratio, and AP latency difference between rarefaction and condensation clicks. We find it helpful to use the Eclipse equipment because the curves show a nice morphology, good amplitudes, not only on the screen but on the printout as well. Sometimes it may be difficult to correctly identify the baseline. To overcome the situation, be sure you have a low electrical noise level. As I told before, we always disconnect the microscope from the power supply before starting the test. Thank you for watching and good luck with your tests.